Thank you, John, and Leslie, and Lewis, and let me add my welcome to all of theirs, to all of you. This discussion this evening is principally occasioned, as Leslie mentioned, by the publication last summer, 2011, of this volume of Dædalus, which she said I edited, the title of which is The Modern American Military. And for those of you who know the collection or will become acquainted with it, it has two aims. One is to try to examine what the United States military does today, and secondly, who does it, and why, and how do they do it. I chose as an epigraph for this volume a maxim from Cicero, which in English reads, "Arms are of little value in the field unless there is wise counsel at home." And I chose that particular maxim in order to focus on a theme that runs through all of the essays in this volume, and I think will be prominent in our discussion this evening, about the critical importance of the relationship between military institutions and civil society. The importance of that relationship was driven home to me in a very vivid way during a visit to an ROTC encampment at Fort Lewis, Washington, in the summer of 2008, where I was a witness for about a week or so at an operation called Warrior Forge, where ROTC cadets, Army cadets, in their the summer between their junior and senior year, do a 5-week course in leadership training. And umpteen times over the course of that week, various officers who were running the program asked me a version of the following question: how can it be that the Army is at war, but the nation is not? That focused for me very sharply the kinds of issues that concern us here this evening. More recently, last May, in his graduation address at West Point, the then chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Admiral Michael Mullen, put the point a little more comprehensively. He said the following: "There isn't a town or city I visit," he said, "where people do not convey to me their great pride in what we do. Even those who do not support the wars support the troops. But I fear they do not know us. I fear they do not comprehend the full weight of the burden we carry or the price we pay when we return from battle. This is important because a people uninformed about what they are asking the military to endure is a people inevitably unable to fully grasp the scope of the responsibilities our Constitution levies upon them. Were we," and he goes on to say, "were we more representative of the population, were more American families touched by military service, perhaps a more advantageous familiarity would ensue. But we are a small force, rightly volunteers, and less than 1% of the population, scattered about the country due to base closings and frequent and lengthy deployments. We are also fairly insular," he said, "speaking our own language of sorts and living within our own unique culture." So that was Admiral Mullen's description of the kind of issue that we're looking at. And just by way of establishing that this is not a purely academic matter, I refer you to the cover story in Time magazine on November 21st, 2011, a rather extensive article, the title of which is "An Army Apart." And for those of you who have further interest in this, I also call your attention to a recent publication of an extensive bit of survey data by the Pew Research Center entitled "War and Sacrifice in the Post-9/11 Era," released on October 5th, 2011. You can find it online. So we're going to, the volume that we edited, put together last summer, it begins with an overview of national security doctrine and perceived needs, both present and going forward, how they have changed and how they are likely to be adapted to changing circumstances in the future. The volume discusses both strategic and tactical doctrines. It has a lot to say about force configuration and composition and the demography of the force, and the experience, the lived actual experience of people in service, both in the battle space and when they return to civil society. One of our premises in the volume, and again our discussion this evening, is that today's force is not your father's force, or even certainly not your grandfather's force. It is, first of all, voluntary. It has been voluntary since 1973, It's also exceptionally small by historical standards. It's about 0.5% of the American population actually serves in uniform today. In the World War II era, it was well over 10% of the entire U.S. population, 16 million people served in uniform. It's also, and this is a point of some controversy, I acknowledge, but it's also objectively the case that our current force is relatively inexpensive. The Department of Defense budget consumes about 5% of GDP. Again, in the World War II era, at the height of that conflict, the armed forces accounted for 40% of GDP. At the height of the Cold War, it was about 8 to 10% of GDP. So by historical standards, our force is not only relatively small in terms of the population, but it's relatively inexpensive in the context of the $14 trillion economy we now have. In the Pew data, you will find many other markers of just how different the force is and how different the experience of service is from what it was for our forebears. For example, in the Pew data, it tells us that self-reported data, 44%, nearly half of returning veterans from the Afghan and Iraq theaters report that they have had difficulty readjusting to civilian life. The same data with respect to people who served before 9/11 turned up self-reporting of only 25% who reported difficulty adjusting to civilian life. 37% of post-9/11 service people self-report post-traumatic stress disorder. 16% only of pre-9/11 service people so self-reported. 36% of the enlisted ranks are registered Republicans as opposed to 23% in the population at large. 60% of the officer corps is Republican as opposed to, as contrasted with 23% in the Republic at large. And of course, the force is, to repeat, an all-volunteer force. African Americans, for example, because it's an all-volunteer force, it is an unrepresentative force. African Americans, for example, make up a little less than 13% of the people in the 18 to 44-year-old labor force cohort, but they make up nearly 20% of the enlisted ranks in the U.S. military. Hispanics, on the other hand, account for about 17% of the 18 to 44-year-old labor force cohort, but a little less than 13% of the U.S. military. Women make up 51% of the people in the 18 to 44-year-old age cohort, labor force cohort, but 14% of the military. So there are distortions, you might say. The demography of the military force does not map precisely onto the demographic profile of the society at large. I mentioned that it's a small force. There is one footnote to that, or corrective. The official size of the force understates the number of people who are actually committed to the mission. As we may hear later from General Ambassador Eikenberry, in Iraq and Afghanistan, at the height of those conflicts, more than half of the U.S. personnel on the ground were not in uniform, but were contractors, which raises all kinds of questions about the command and control structure and their accountability. I see the red light flashing here, so I am going to cut my remarks short. I'm sure we'll have time to have more dialogue about this, but I wanted to end, as I pass the baton to Bill Perry, to my right, by quoting someone who's already been quoted this evening, George Washington, early member of the American Academy, who said the following in 1783. He said, "It may be laid down as a primary position and the basis of our system that every citizen who enjoys the protection of a free government owes not only a proportion of his property, but even of his personal services to the defense of it." That is not the system we have today. Bill?